There you go. So, do you guys know what a Where's Waldo book is? Have you guys ever seen those before? No, you haven't? You have, but you know. Yeah. Maybe your parents will show you where a Where's Waldo book, but I have a different kind of book with me here today. I would like you guys to count how many dinosaurs you see in these pictures. So which one is it? Is it 10 or 11?
12.
There's 15. Are you sure? Let's count them together. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. There were 11. Pastor miscounted earlier. He only saw 10. But can you guys find the dinosaur that has a slice of pizza as its flag? Who can see it?
Right over there.
Right over where? Where is it? That one right there. That's good. It's impressive that you guys were able to find the dinosaur with the pizza with all these other dinosaurs around him. He has a meteor.
Who does?
Are you sure? It could. Is it a meteor or is it a cookie?
Cookie.
It's a cookie.
It's a cookie.
It's a chocolate chip cookie. So you can find all kinds of things in these picture books.
Can we look at another page?
But maybe we'll look at another page after the service is over with. Okay. But hold that thought. Ask your mom and dad afterwards, all right? But God looks for us. He finds us. No matter all the different things that distract us from him, he's always able to locate us no matter where we are or what's going on. Because God cares for us and he wants us to be with him. Can we thank him for that? Why don't we bow our heads together? Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending Jesus to find us in all the world, to call us to be his own child. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, friends. I'm going to let you go back to your parents, all right? Thanks for coming up. We'll see you guys again soon. You're going to take that back to mom? Go ahead. It was his book originally. I did take it. We'll sing the final stanza of our hymn, 596. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and give a willing spirit to sustain me. Amen. Dear friends in the faith, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Ready or not, here I come. Chances are you all remember playing hide and go seek, right? It's a staple growing up. Everyone likes to play hide and go seek. The funny thing is that all the hiding spots tended to be the same, weren't they? We try and hide behind a closed door, or behind some furniture. We might try and sneak underneath a pile of clothes. Or, if we could fit, we might try and hide underneath the bed. Yet did you ever find a spot that was so good and so unexpected that no one found you? Were you ever so well hidden that people had to announce, okay, it's time to come out, we give up, you won? Chances are, if you found that kind of spot, you were pretty excited about the feeling that you had that no one found you because you were that good at hiding. Well, chances are, Adam and Eve in our text for this morning were hoping that they found a spot equally as good so that God would never find them, so that they could say, we won because we escaped what was coming. Yet the thing is that this was no game of hide and seek. This was no game of winners and losers. There were just defeat all around. But it doesn't stop God from looking. He constantly looks for them, not because he didn't know where they were, but because he wanted to give them an opportunity to come out, to give up and acknowledge their defeat. God's call constantly goes out to us because God never stops seeking us. There were five participants in this game: God, Adam and Eve, the serpent, and Satan. And based off of what we heard in our reading for this morning from Genesis 3, who would you say was winning? God created Adam to be perfect, to stand in his presence and see him face to face on a daily basis. But no longer. Mankind lost that likeness of God, just as mankind was lost from God. So was God winning? What about Adam and Eve? Adam was given the knowledge of God's will and the ability to carry it out. He was given dominion over the earth and the responsibility of looking after all of the creatures that exist on this planet. And Eve was formed from the very body of her husband. She was his suitable helper. She was his encourager, his support system. They were created to be blameless and unblemished. They were walking around in a beautiful, lush garden with perfect temperatures, no humidity, perfectly 70 degrees, most likely. And they were walking around in the nude with no shame whatsoever. However, now, shame was all they knew. Were Adam and Eve winning? Not much is known about the serpent, except the fact that it was a crafty animal and it was an irrational creature that was used as a tool of destruction by an even more venomous beast. The price of playing in this game was a state of humiliation for this specific serpent and all of its family. To slither on its belly and eat the dust of the ground, to serve as a symbol of fear and death. Was the serpent winning? And then there was Satan, whose name in Greek means adversary, but that's not who he was created to be. No, he was an angel of light. He was called Lucifer, the light bringer, who stood in the council of God and advised him and served his God faithfully. And then something happened. And after this, he was forever known as the father of lies and a murderer, not one who brought light, but one who brought darkness. The one who enabled hatred and animosity to exist between God and mankind. Surely he thought he had won. But did he? God records for us here in chapter 3, which has often been entitled Mankind's Fall into Sin. That's what's labeled in every single one of your Bibles, no matter what the translation is. The problem with that is that the editors are wrong. You see, a fall implies that Adam and Eve were moving around, moseying on about their business, when suddenly, from no fault of their own, they trip up and fall into a trap. Except that's not what happens here. The Lord God told the man, "You may eat from any tree in the garden, but do not eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, for the day that you eat it, you will surely die." So it doesn't matter how crafty the serpent was. It doesn't matter how much of a smooth talker Satan may have been. God said, "Don't eat it." And because they chose to, there were consequences that followed. Man didn't fall into sin. Adam and Eve leaped headlong into it. And those consequences for sin are various. The first one they're going to talk about, though, is shame. They heard the voice of the Lord God who was walking around in the garden, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord. The Lord God was the one that was seeking them, and how appropriate. The Lord, the faithful one, the merciful, gracious one, who is kind and loving and showers his blessings on all his creation. That was the one who was seeking them. That was the one who was calling out after them. But also God, the all-powerful, mighty God of the universe, who created everything by the majestic word of his command, the same command that carried off an instruction: do not eat from that tree. And after they did, they hid themselves because of shame. Shame and guilt are very closely related, but there's a very thin line that divides it. Shame is what people experience when they mess up and others know it because they catch them in the act. That's what was going on here. And Adam and Eve were foolish enough to think that, let's just go into the bushes. Let's hide ourselves in the tree line, as though the God who created it couldn't find them or see them. But we can't sit here and snicker at their ridiculous notions all that much, because we do the same. We may not be trying to hide ourselves in the foliage outside, but we do try and hide our sin when we sweep it under the rug as though it never happened. Shame causes us to conceal our transgressions by hiding them away deep in the crevices of our mind, as though God himself were not present when we actually plan them out and carry through on those sins. As if God is not able to peel back the layers of our mind to reveal the atrocities that we commit. Yet the Lord God never stops seeking his children. And he calls out, "Where are you?" The Lord God also seeks you and me. He is our faithful Father who made us to stand in his presence, not to hide from it. He's our Father who comes to us and calls us to shower his love on us, to remind us that we are never far from his thoughts, who sends his voice out to call us no matter where we are, not for his benefit, but for ours, so that we heed his call to repent and seek the mercy from the one who constantly goes out to find us. "Where are you? I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid." Adam and Eve didn't listen. Shame was why they hid themselves, but the reason they felt shame was because of fear. Instead of clinging to the presence of the God who created them, when that slippery serpent slithered throughout the garden, they clung to the promise of the devil instead. "You won't die. You'll be like God. You'll know both good and evil." And doesn't want you to be like him. They swallowed it, hook, line, and sinker. They trusted in the promise of the devil, so much so that there was nothing left between them and God except fear of his judgment and his wrath. Fear is what also moves us. Fear to stay hidden. When we think things like, God can't possibly forgive me for this. It's too big. It's too huge. It's better for me just to deny it, like it never happened in the first place. God's more likely to squash me like a bug, or worse, forsake me. I'll just forget. That's not who our Creator is. That's not what he does. He doesn't come to us in a rage with a firm, steady hand. No. He comes to us with his arms wide open to wrap us up in the comfort of his love and to always seek us by calling out to you and to me, "Where are you?" I was afraid because I was naked. So I hid myself. How interesting that both of them are actually hiding in the tree line, but only Adam is the one who voices his response to God's call. Where was that leadership when the serpent came in? Where was that leadership when falsehood was presented to Adam and Eve? The reason why they were hiding wasn't because they were naked. They hid because they did what God forbade. And then they tried to use that same falsehood on God that the devil used on them. They mimicked his deceit. No, the reason why we're hiding is because we're naked. We care for you so much that we don't want your eyes to be bothered by our doings. We care about propriety. Ridiculous. It was God himself who formed them, who made them, who saw them every day in their nakedness. He didn't care. And yet you and I, we mimic that same deceitful attitude. We say things like, "No, I wasn't rolling my eyes at what you said. I had an eyelash that was caught underneath my eyelid right here. And I was just trying to get it out by rolling my eyes like this." We say things like, "No, I wasn't slandering that person. I was just blowing off some steam. Forget about it." We say things like, "No, I wasn't looking lustfully or gawking at that man or that woman. I was just admiring their clothing." "No, I don't hate that individual. I just don't particularly like the way they speak, the way they talk, or generally present themselves in public." Our falsehood is how we deal with questions about our improper attitudes and about our deplorable thoughts that make us hostile to God and others. And nobody deserves God's wrath. That's not what he displays. Nor does he scorn us for our lies, or let us hide behind our deceitful motives. He calmly leads us by his voice to the truth with tenderness and compassion in his heart. He seeks us through the darkness of falsehood and shines light in the crevices of our mind where we're too ashamed to acknowledge the garbage that we actually do. Where we're too ashamed to acknowledge the evil that we perpetrate. "Who told you you were naked?" Did you eat from the tree that I told you not to eat from? And the last result of sin that we're going to look at this morning is blame. Well, the woman that you gave to be with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it. What have you done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me and I ate. Hiding didn't work. Denial failed. God saw right through their deceitful plans. What's left? Let's pass the buck to somebody else. Let's throw someone else under the bus, right? Adam did it to Eve. Eve did it to the serpent and subsequently Satan. But there's one other person that got thrown under the bus. Did you catch it? The woman you gave to be with me. Are you kidding? Look at the deplorable corruption of sin, not just in relation between man and God, but with each other already. It was his wife, not anymore. She was bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh, not any longer. She was his helper, his suitable helpmate, one to encourage and guide and give strength. No, no. Now it was that one right there. She's the problem. In other words, what Adam is saying is, you know what? God, this all could have been avoided. It's your fault, really. I mean, you gave her to me. I was just fine on my own. If you think about it, you're the one to blame. But this isn't really hard for us to believe, is it? People do it all the time. Parents, you see it with your kids, right? When you go up to little Johnny, Johnny, why did you hit Susie? They hit me first! But it doesn't just happen there. We do it too. Yes. I slammed on my brakes, but they were tailgating me all the way up 223. Yeah, I was mean to them, but they made fun of me. Yes, honey, I yelled at you in public, but you were disrespecting me. Yeah, I may have leered a little too long at that man or woman, but really, did you see the outfit they were wearing? I mean, come on. Yes, I yelled at them for helping, but really, they were doing it wrong in the first place. Yes, Pastor, I would be in church more on a regular basis, but I can't control the schedule that my coach's kids give to them. It's really their fault. Despite our best efforts to throw that hot potato into somebody else's lap, God doesn't buy it. He sees right through it. God constantly seeks us by keeping us center stage in his gaze and by constantly calling us to lead us back from that wayward path that we find ourselves on time and time again. He doesn't do it by executing his justice and proclaiming his judgment, but what he does is quite the opposite. He compassionately proclaims his promise. Where are you? I got this. I'll take care of you. I'm going to restore and reclaim what was lost. You. So who's the winner? There isn't one. There's just the victor. The seed of the woman who crushed the serpent's head not by a heel, but by the hell he suffered on the cross. The seed of the woman who sought us to reestablish peace that was lost between God and us by bringing us back into the family of God through his obedience to the Lord's commands. The seed of the woman made us his. He constantly seeks us. He found us when we wanted to remain hidden. He claimed us while we were still his enemies. And he showered his love on each and every one of us, even though there's nothing lovable about us. We can count to whatever number we want. It doesn't matter. And it doesn't matter if we're ready or not, because God always finds us. And thank the Lord he does. He finds us whether we're in the deepest, darkest places of despair or whether we're in the bright, shining days of joy. Friends, he finds us because God never stops seeking us. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. And give me a willing spirit to sustain. Amen. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guards our hearts and our minds through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.